Thanks. Okay. Sorry. Thank you very much. This is actually, I think, the third or fourth time I've been at Loyola. I was at Loyola many, many years ago when a friend of mine, Deborah Walker, was a professor here. And then Dan came down here, and Leo. So we have a lot of people here that I'm very friendly with, and love to been worked with a lot of the students that came out of this university as well. Can you tune it down just a little bit? Okay, feedback here. Is that better? You can still hear me back there? Okay, so the way I wanted to do this was sort of explain a little bit about the book and what I'm trying to do in the book to all of you. The book, just so that, not to disappoint you, right, the book is really written for two audiences. Most of, in which many of you don't qualify to be in that audience, okay? The book was written for kids who are seniors in college who are deciding to go get a PhD in economics, okay? And people who are in their last year of their PhD program deciding that they're going to be professors of economics. And that's who the book is really targeted at, because it's directed at kids that are deciding to go on to get a PhD in economics to try to get them to think about what kind of economist do I want to be, all right? Because when you go to graduate school, you're not really always given that much time to think about that question, because you're learning all the techniques and ideas and whatnot that constitute modern economics. And so you really have to have somewhat of a strong identity when you go to graduate school to decide, okay, this is the kind of economist that I want to be. And then it's also directed at last year graduate students that are going on to become professors, to ask them what kind of professor that they want to be. The reality is that all the incentives in higher education are somewhat skewed for people to not be very good professors. You don't really get rewarded for how good a teacher you are. You get rewarded for how well you do research. And in fact, the greatest plum jobs in academics come with zero teaching. Gordon Tullock was one of my teachers. He's a brilliant economist. He was also a teacher of Professor D'Amico here and many of the other people around here. And Tullock, when I was a graduate student, had one student sign up for his class one semester, and that's not allowed, right? You normally need four students at least to teach your seminar, but for Gordon Tullock, they would let it slip. And the secretary turned to him and said, "Professor Tullock, you only have one student." And he said, "One more than optimal." Tullock was a famous professor, and so the natural incentive for most students that get out of graduate school and start teaching a job is to take whatever they learned as a PhD student and water it down to teach to undergraduate students, because that way they don't have to do any prep time, right? And the problem with that is, in a field like economics, that makes economics come across really, really, really boring. And so one of the common difficulties I've had, I always found economics to me changed my life. All right, I did not go to graduate school, or I didn't go to undergraduate school with the thought of being a graduate school student and then a professor. All right, I only read one book outside of sports books before I went to college, and that was The Godfather. I will not tell you the reasons why, I explained that earlier. But I read a lot of, books about athletes and stuff, but no other novels or whatever. I went to college, and the original college that I went there to play basketball. That's all I wanted to do. I wanted to be a high school basketball coach. And I was far away from home. It was a school that, recruited me to go play basketball there for them. And I got a season-ending injury, and I went through college very, very depressed. And in the spring, my girlfriend back home decided to go to college near me out there, but she wasn't allowed to go to the same school as me. And by according to her parents. And I was doing something for the coach on a Saturday, and the coach annoyed me. And I didn't have a car at college, and I went to back to the dorm, and I said, let's go down and see where my girlfriend's going to go to college. Maybe I'll go there. And I got in the car, and I went down there, and serendipity, we were walking on the campus, and the director of admissions was walking on the campus and says, this is at, 1 o'clock on a Saturday afternoon, and he says, what are you young men doing here? Because we look scruffy and not very, we shouldn't be there. And I said, what are you doing here? And I said, I told him my life story or whatever. And the guy says, oh, that's funny. I just came from the basketball office. Let me drop you over there. And I went over there, and the basketball coaches at Grove City got me into school, basically. And I ended up by going to Grove City, but then I got hurt again. But I had to I wanted to be a high school basketball coach. And the summer before I went to college, I worked digging pools. Well, I worked two jobs. Half of the summer I worked digging pools, and then I worked at a factory. Both of these jobs had a huge impact on me in wanting to become an economist. The first thing was is that when I was working at digging pools, was in the middle of gas shortages. This is in the late 1970s. Just like you saw on TV a week ago in New Jersey, this is what happened, and we had rationing of gasoline of $5 was the most you could put in. Now keep in mind that gasoline was about 33 cents a gallon, okay? But $5 was the most you could put in your car. And so in the trucks, which are big guzzlers, right? We siphoned gasoline. We'd fill one truck and then we'd siphon the gasoline to do it. Well, I was the youngest kid on the crew. Who do you think got to siphon the gasoline? So, if you think I'm crazy, you can blame it on this. I had to suck on a tube, get the gasoline flowing, which means that it got into my mouth, then tried to shove it into the gas tank over there and move it there every day. Every day, I hated this job. So, then what happened was my girlfriend's neighbor saw that I was beat up from this job, and she offered me a job working in an electric factory for what turned out, I'm a huge Yankee fan, and it turned out to be the glorious period of the summer, because it was right when the Yankees, and get ready for this, caught up to the Red Sox and ended up by beating the Red Sox after they were out of first place. And that's when Bucky Dent hit his famous thing that the Red Sox fans still can't stand. But so I had to quit my job at the thing. So this comes another hard lesson. So I won. I'm pissed off. I have to suck on a tube every day. And then what happens is, I'm from New Jersey. The man who ran the pool digging company was Tony. Just like Tony Soprano. And exactly that same, not just the same ethnic group, same. It was a front for the mob, the whole thing was going on, right? So I go there to pick up my pay for the last week that I worked there, because I'm going off to this other job for, and he says, why didn't you show up for work? I said, remember, I told you I'm moving to another job, you owe me money. And he says, like that. And he was in the jacuzzi. I'm not making this up. And just so imagine a guy about 5 foot five, about 5 foot five wide, in a Speedo, bald, with the gold chain with the horn, and he had a silk robe that he put on, and he took me back to the back room, and he got money out of the cash box, and he says, all right, and he paid me. I was making minimum wage, all right? So somewhere around $180 for the week that he goes to pay me. So he hands me the cash. I hold it. Before I can make a step, he goes, and he snatches it from me. And then he says, withholding. And he takes out the amount of money for withholding, puts it in his little pouch of the silk thing, and hands me the money back. Which, okay, so I started with a stack like that. Now I have a stack like this. And I'm like, withholding. God damn it. I shouldn't say that here at Loyola. But I'm from New Jersey, so I just, I was pissed off. So I go off to college, to this new college, and I have two things that are annoying me. One, I hate gas lines. Why do I have to have gas lines? It sucks. This should not be the way the world is. No gas lines. And I don't want Tony grabbing my money and saying withhold it. Which, by the way, Tony just becomes another thing for the state. Right? Because they're grabbing you and saying, give me your withholding. Why is he taking my money? I earned, worked hard. I had to suck on that too. I deserve that money. So I go off to college, still only with the intent of wanting to be a high school basketball coach if I can't make it in basketball at a higher level. And I'm sitting in the back of the room, and I got my baseball cap on and my sweatpants, and probably socks and flip-flops, because that was the wear, you know, at the time. But long-sleeve t-shirts. I always wore long-sleeve t-shirts. And Dr. Senholz, who was my economics professor, says to me, perhaps a student from Slippery Rock State College has slipped into our room. And I'm like, that's interesting. Who's the hell from Slippery Rock that's here? And then he stares me down. This German guy stares me down. And he says, at Grove City College, we do not wear ball caps inside. So I take my hat off, and I, like, what would you think right now, right? You think, like, okay, I got a jackass for a teacher, right? So the first day of school, and I got a jackass for a teacher. And then he proceeds to explain to me and to the class why it is that we had gas shortages in the United States at the time. It had to do with government policy, just like what had to do with government policy last week, Governor Christie gets on and says, I want everyone to know that if anyone raises the price, you're going to be busted under, you know, anti-gouging laws. So what happened? No one raised price, right? Therefore, no supplies come in, right? If you watch this, go ahead and look it up. There's black markets. You had to wait in line for 6 hours, but you could also pay a black marketeer to get $50 for one of those like red containers full of gas, right? Many people would rather pay $50 than wait in line for 6 hours to get gasoline to fill their tank, right? So Senholz explains this. I don't have a blackboard here, but basically he put up a supply and demand curve and I fell in love, right? It literally, I sat back there and it gave me focus of the two things that, you know, became very important to me. One is the miracle of how markets operate and how government intervention into the market can distort those markets. And two, who's the source of that intervention, right, is the state, which is also the person taking the money from me in Tony's pocket, right? So I became convinced that anyone, so then I go off to graduate school eventually after a long little thing like that, and I become an economics professor as a graduate student. And I used to get upset that I didn't have 100% conversion rate, right? Because I love economics. And my friend, Dave Pacheco, who's a co-author with me on our textbook called The Economic Way of Thinking, Dave said to me at the time, he goes, Pete, don't you know we're the weird ones? And I'm like, what do you mean? He goes, not everyone loves economics. I'm like, how could they not love economics? This is the greatest thing in the world. Look at that supply and demand curve. That's the sexiest thing you will ever see. You gotta love economics, right? How can that be? Dave would just shake his head and say, you really are pretty sick, Pete. So ever since that time, I've always been amazed. I go to cocktail parties with my wife, who was my girlfriend back then, right? So now we were childhood sweethearts, and now we've been together 30 years, married next June. We go to these parties, and you know, either she introduces me or I have to introduce myself, and they say, you know, what do you do for a living? And I say, oh, I'm an economics professor. And inevitably, I get, you know, one of three reactions. The first reaction, and the most common one, is that the person acts like I just gave them sour milk. That's the worst class I ever had in college, right? That's because a lot of economics professors are like the caricatures in the movies, right? So, you know who's one of the most dynamic economics professors in the movies ever? Right? Have you seen this movie, Larry Crown? George Takei? right? You've seen it, right? That's like a positive portrayal of an economics professor, right? Here's a bad portrayal of an economics professor, right? In the movie Back to School, right? The jerk, right, that's upset, you know, with his, you know, like that. Here's another one, in Ferris Bueller's Day Off, right? That's what people think about economics. So the old joke is that, God invented economists because he wanted to make sure accountants looked interesting. Right? So everybody, they look at you like this. So economics to me is this amazing subject, and yet somehow people don't get sucked into doing economics. To me, once you get exposed to economics, you should all want to be a major, right? I know Catherine here is a historian. No way! You gotta be an economist, right? You know, someone else here tell me they're a lawyer. Hey, how about economics, right? It's economics 24/7. I know, I'm in a Jesuit school, right? So we have all these things like that. Absolute economics is absolute ethics. Bring it home, right? You want to know why it is that people are poor in Africa, right? It's about economics, right? And so this is how I feel, and not everyone else feels that way. And instead, they feel like, God, this is the most boring subject in the world. So that's the first reaction. I don't really have much to do with that one, right? What do I do? They think I'm perverse, right? Here's the second reaction. Oh, do you know where interest rates are going? So I become snarky, which is, I always say, if I didn't answer that question, I wouldn't be at this party with you. I'd be in Barbados, right? Having a grand old time. One of my favorite commercials right now is one with Thomas Sargent, who won the Nobel Prize 2 years ago. And they're asking him about what CD rates are going to be. And they go, Thomas Sargent, one of the smartest men in the world, which he is. And he says, what are CD rates going to be next year? And he says, I don't know. Right? We don't know. We don't have a crystal ball to tell you about how to invest or anything like that, okay? The third response, which is rare, and it happens only in occasions like this when I'll meet students from Florida State, or I, run into kids from Loyola, or I run into my own graduate students, as I say, oh my God, economics is the greatest thing in the world. I love it. I stayed up at night thinking about economics. I want to be an economist. And that's who I think everyone should be. Right? And so, but I rarely run into that person. Most of the time, it's the other three. So this is part of the things that puzzles me about thinking about, what we're doing wrong as economic communicators. The arguments that we have in economics, the argument for free trade, for example, has been more tested and more argued than any other proposition in the social sciences and the policy sciences, and always proven to be right. And yet, we pass legislation constantly for mohair subsidies and, shoes need to do this and protection and all these things like that. All right, if you doubt what I just said about the proposition being tested and proven right, take a look at Doug Irwin's book, all right, called Against the Tide. It's a history of free trade and the debates. He's a professor at Dartmouth, all right, and he goes through all the various different debates and walks you through all of the different ways in which people have tried to counter free market, free trade arguments, what the empirical evidence is, and everything like that. All right, there's not an argument for an infant industry, right? It doesn't have any empirical legs, doesn't have any analytical legs. All right, and yet we constantly have this thing. Why are we such bad communicators? And that was one of the things that really puzzled me. So the way I'm going to do this is I want to go through and sort of explain the origins and history and the meaning of this. So what I want you to do is take a good look at that title and the cover and burn it into your memory, because I'm going to keep making reference to the allusions and the titles here. Like in all good things in my life, the title Living Economics wasn't my original title. It was a title that was suggested, but my wife was the one who said, Rosemary said, Clayton, that's the one, that's the title. My titles were your typical boring academic titles. Economics for yesterday, today, and tomorrow. That was the title that I had, and everyone's like, yeah, that doesn't work. And then I had some other title, economic truth, colon, five names afterwards or something like that, so it didn't work, but they came up with this title. And so I want to try to explain the contents of the books by reference to the title and to the cover art. So the very first point is that economic science itself is a constantly evolving and living and breathing body of scientific thought. Economics is not a catechism. What economics is an invitation to inquiry. One of the reasons why students get turned off to economics is because we present the material in economics as if it's a conversation stopper. But instead, economics is a conversation beginner. It's the way to get people to think about how the world is organized, and it's amazing intellectual. It taps into the greatest traditions in the history of Western civilization, and greatest thinkers in the history of Western civilization. It's an amazing sort of discipline. This is my favorite economist, Ludwig von Mises. The book actually ends with quotes from Mises. I'll explain that in a little bit. But this is the guiding thing that has driven a large part of my own intellectual efforts as an economist, is this recognition of Mises. I read Mises' great treatise, Human Action, as an invitation to people to study economics in all man, study man in all walks of life, in a variety of circumstances, all right, in a variety of settings, from the church to the corporate room to the classroom and everything like that, and that economics is this great conversation that's constantly evolving, and that's reflected in the tree by the growing branches. The tree, if you look at the cover, right, has these healthy branches that are growing. None of them are barren. They're all moving out and growing. And it's constantly evolving. As Mises says here, to claim that economics is backward because there's constant debates and discussion among economists is to misunderstand the nature of science. Right? To be a living body of thought, you're constantly evolving and changing, meeting new challenges, going in new directions. Economics didn't stop in 1776, it didn't stop in the 1820s, it certainly didn't stop in 1920 or 1940. It's constantly evolving, and when we talk to our students, we have to get them to be excited about where they can take economic arguments, where they can, you know, evolve as thinkers and bring those to the problems that we face today. Ludwig von Mises is the greatest economic mind, in my estimation. But he didn't even know what the internet was, right? How can he talk about the world that we live in today, right, in some sense, in terms of the application of economic reasoning? You have to do that, right? Now, how do you go about doing that? Well, here comes the second part, which is, go again, look at that tree. That tree is deeply rooted in the ground. If a tree is not deeply rooted in the ground, right, it topples over. The science of economics is deeply rooted, and those roots find themselves in the Scottish Enlightenment, in the thinking of David Hume and Adam Smith. And they go forward with the French liberal school of Basquiat and Jean-Baptiste Say. And they continue further with the British utilitarians, John Stuart Mill. All right, and then they evolve eventually into the Austrian school of economics, which is the Austrian marginalists and Austrian subjectivists, which goes from Menger to Mises to Hayek, and then develops further with public choice economics, new institutional economics, property rights economics, experimental economics. Economics is constant, but it's the men who sit in the seat of Adam Smith. This is Lord Acton. All right? How many heard of Lord Acton? Come on, power. How many heard the phrase, power tends to corrupt absolute, power tends to corrupt absolutely? All right, that's Lord Acton. Okay? This is a letter that Lord Acton is writing to Lady Gladstone, who's asking him about contemporary politics, meaning like the most recent thing that we just went through. Imagine, you know, someone writing about the Ryan Biden debate to you, or the Obama Romney debate, the third debate. What do you think? Where's this going? All these things like that. And what Acton writes back is, he says, it's not these men of the moment. It's not the popular politics of the day that you should be paying attention to. It's the men who sit in the seat of Adam Smith that are worthy of our attention. It's understanding the systemic principles that understand the society of free and responsible individuals that we should be exploring and examining. And that's what ACTIN is trying to emphasize here. All right? So, that tree and those branches are healthy based on the idea that they're grounded and rooted in the ideas of Adam Smith. And then they branch out and they go in these various different directions, and they're healthy to the extent that they're built into that foundation. So it's not that economics is constantly made anew every day. Right? That you have to rethink the foundations. What you have to do is rethink the branches in which you're going out in. And here's the final one. This goes back to my own experience. Once you get really seduced by the logic of economics, and you really understand it, it is really hard to think about anything else. It's the way that you view everything in the world. These questions are not questions just of like trivial matter. They're the questions about fundamental life and death. All right, here's a homework assignment for all of you, especially those of you who are in Leo's class, okay? Because you're taking stats. I want you to write this down. It's a YouTube video. It's called 200 Countries Over 200 Years in 4 Minutes. It's a video that's produced by BBC and a thing called The Joy of Stats. Okay? It's by a man named Hans Riesling. And what he shows is that over the last 200 years, everyone began in very poor and sick. All of us were poor and sick. So on this axis, we're going to plot per capita income. On this axis, we're going to plot life expectancy. Okay? So if you go back 200 years, all right, we have very few countries that came close to the top of that period of being poor and sick, which would be life expectancy around 40 and per capita income around 4,000. Go forward 200 years, and now what you have is people having life expectancy around 80, and per capita income in some other countries over 40,000. And what he does in this video is he shows that you start out here, all the countries here. Obviously, by the way, Great Britain is up top at the 200 years ago, right? And then what happens is you get countries like this. This is the Industrial Revolution. And then they go like this, and then you go like this. So you get what's called in economics a hockey stick. Most of human history is like this. Deirdre McCloskey, who is a very dynamic economist, she does this. She says, okay, everyone get ready. Here's the tricky thing. She goes, here's human history. And she walks across the stage. And then she stops. She says, here's the tricky part. Right? And that's been the mystery that economists have been trying to understand. That's called the Industrial Revolution. Adam Smith's book is called The Inquiry into the Nature and Causes of the Wealth of Nations. Why? Adam Smith is trying to explain that tick up, right? Hans Riesling is explaining this, right? Here we go, like this. What's the tragedy? Some countries are still here, right? They're still down in the, barely, you know, out of the sick and poor, right? That's underdevelopment problem. And then you have other countries up here, okay? So what we want to understand is, you know, what generated that idea? And then once you start thinking about that, realize what that means. We don't need growth rates. But you do experience female ability to have access to education. If you're poor and sick, people don't have access to education. If you're healthy and wealthy, yep. Here's a bigger mystery for you. If you're from Afghanistan in 1960, it was better for you to be a woman in Afghanistan in 1960 than a woman to be in Afghanistan in 1990. That's weird. Why would that be the case? Okay? Those are the kind of questions. And you can't go to sleep. Some of you are sleeping already. But, you know, if you get really into this, you can't go to sleep thinking about this. This is what, Bob Lucas. And this is what he's in this essay called The Mechanics of Economic Development. It says in this thing, once one starts to think about them, it's hard to think about anything else. Engineering department or in the English literature department? Come on, you all know, right? English literature, what's their opportunity cost? Driving a cab, right? The engineer, what can they do, right? So what's gonna happen? I'm gonna go into engineering. So if I'm trying to have a battle for, right? If I'm gonna try to have a battle for where I put my department, I'm not gonna put it in the arts, I'm gonna put it in the sciences. And so economics had a very, very strong incentive when they were forming their department to no longer be called departments of political economy, or parts of, actually what they were called before was departments of moral philosophy. They're a branch of moral philosophy. That's what Adam Smith was. He was a professor of moral philosophy. So instead, what I'm going to do is I'm going to be a professor of economics. I'm over there. I get paid the higher wages. I can scoff at all the arts, right? And so that's sort of what happened over here. And so when they start teaching this, the professor, this is Alfred Marshall, is the person who solidified the discipline of economics at Oxford and moved it out of philosophy department and into its own department, okay? And that happens around 1890, and it becomes a very, very big thing. And then that translates over in the United States. So what this professor was saying is, I'm tough. You can't get through. This is principles of economics. So here's the hypothesis that you have to entertain. One, students at Johns Hopkins, who all score around 1400 on their SATs, can't understand basic supply and demand economics. Right, that's one hypothesis. Doesn't seem very plausible. Two, the professor can't teach. That's one hypothesis. Professor doesn't know how to write an exam. Maybe there's another hypothesis. Clearly, hypothesis two and three are more plausible than hypothesis one. But yet, that's what we pride ourselves on all along. That's not how we do it. Teach economics as if it was the last class your students will ever have, and it will be the first of many classes they'll want to take. All right? That's the goal of a good economics professor. The other thing I emphasize in here is that a lot of time in economics classes, because we're not teaching it like it's the first of many class, the last class someone will ever have, we tend to focus on these nuanced points, which tend to lose people, and then we end up by the student only remembers what the exceptions are and not the general principles. So we fail in our part here. So what we need to know is what's enduring and what's fleeting in the history of the discipline of economics and the science. The second part, there are great examples of teachers that teach the principles of economics. They populate schools across, you know, Europe and the United States. They've been fantastic teachers, and I try to select out a bunch of various different teachers and give examples of the way in which they try, through their work and through their teachings, to communicate the core principles of economics. And so we give you a sort of a tour of all these various different people as we walk through that, including many of my own teachers that I was fortunate enough to be exposed to. And then the third part is, how would this change the way we do economics? So here's one of the puzzles in the book, is that since 1950, we have been asking economics to do something which it is constitutionally, I don't mean that legally, I mean by the essence of it, constitutionally unable to do, which is to provide information about something like, remember what I said about the question of Tom Sargent? We expect an economist like that to be able to say, CD rates will be yielding X amount in 5 years from now. It's called forecasting, okay? You know, I don't tell this story in the book, but it's a great story about forecasting. Otto Eckstein was one of the really people who engineered the idea of economic forecasting, ran a thing called Data Resource Management, I think, it was the title of this company. He was an economics professor, and during the 1960s. How many here, by the way, just let me put things in perspective about this date that I picked. How many here know that, let's say, prior to 1913, we didn't have a Federal Reserve System? Okay, so you know that. How about prior to, after World War II, we didn't have a Bretton Woods Agreement, for example, right? That came in 1946. We didn't have a Council of Economic Advisors. Lincoln did not have a Council of Economic Advisors, right? Okay, so Council of Economic Advisors is a product. We passed a law called the Humphrey-Hawkins Act, which demanded that the economic policies generate full employment. Okay, the older people here, does anyone remember that? That was a law that was passed. The government decrees it, that it's a law that you have to have 100%, full employment. Can't have any of this shady stuff. That's a law, okay? All right, so that didn't work out too well. But we have this Council of Economic Advisors, and Kennedy was one of the first ones that really had a big sort of economic team, and then Johnson inherited it. And Johnson used to have economists come in all the time and talk. And Johnson used to get bored. Remember, right, like I said before, bored about economics because, we're making accountants seem interesting, And so these economists would come in, and Johnson would always say, after 5 minutes, the story goes, his eyes would glaze over, and he'd say, "Professor, if you're so smart, how come you ain't rich?" Right, and that would end the conversation, and there we go. So then he has Otto Eckstein coming in. Okay? And Johnson's sitting there, and his aides say, "Mr. President, you cannot say to Professor Eckstein your standard line because he's really, really rich." And so Johnson says, "Okay." But 5 minutes into the talk, Johnson's eyes glaze over, he gets bored, he says, "Professor, I understand you're a very wealthy man." And Eckstein says, "Well, yes, Mr. President, I've been very fortunate. I've done quite well for myself." He says, "Well, tell me, if you're so rich, how come you're so stupid?" Right? So Hayek pointed out that economists have this weird position in which we're called upon more than any other social science to pro-offer advice on pressing matters of public policy, to only have our advice dismissed as soon as it's uttered. Okay? Think about like the fiscal cliff right now and the discussions about that. All right, I will tell you this. My expectations are, and I'm not a great predictor, so don't bet the farm on this, okay? But my view is that they're not gonna face the fiscal cliff because they're gonna kick the grenade down the road, right? Because what's everyone saying in Washington right now? Right, they're having that kumbaya moment. We gotta get together. We gotta do this, right? Because that's what legislation is about. We can do this, right? And they never ask the question, just because you can do something doesn't mean that you should do it. All right? And just like on the opposite, just because you should do something doesn't mean you can do it. Right? And there's a constraint, a real constraint on sometimes. We want to eliminate this, but we might not have the abilities to do it. So think about that as you go through these things. There's both the just because you can doesn't mean that you should, and just because you should doesn't mean that you can. All right, think through those various different bubbles there. So economists are in this kind of very strange position. So what actually would be the kind of position that I would hold if the economics teaching? One of massive humility. What economists are at best social critics. They engage in criticism of existing proposals. So you tell me, you're the Gator man here, right? So he's like the President of the United States, and he says, "I want to help the least advantaged in society," that's his goal. And then he proposes a bunch of policies to me. And what I can do as an economist is I don't dispute with him his goal. What I do is examine the effectiveness of his chosen means to his ends that he tries to get at. That's the most important role that economists have. Here's the problem with that. What economists do is they put parameters on people's utopias. Right? He says, "Oh, I want to go to the Olympics." And I say, "That's cool, you want to go to the Olympics?" And he says, "Yeah, and here's the means. I'm going to eat chocolate cake every day." And I say, you know what? Chocolate might not be, screw you, I like chocolate. Right? That's what's going on, right, with this, right? Is that you have means that are insufficient to obtain the end sought after, and the economist is the one telling you you can't do that. And so what's your reaction? I don't like what you're telling me. Okay? So I'm going to have economic growth. Right now, in our policies, I'll talk about this in a second, but you know, our policies have constantly traded off long-run economic growth in order to have short-run economic relief. Well, what you can't do is have the relief and have the growth. Right? You can't bail out inefficient firms and not cause perverse incentives which distort long-term economic growth. All right, and that's where the difficulty comes from. Economists, by the way, don't have a problem with, say, recognizing that people have different endowments and that there may, in fact, be tremendous injustice in those endowments. Right? You're randomly given this, certain, you know, advantages in life and other people that. Here's the question that economists always ask. I can level endowments, but can I level those endowments without distorting incentives? If I end up by distorting the incentives, I'm going to end up by not fixing the endowment problem. And so we always have to examine those kind of questions. Okay? So Hayek sums up the position of the economist by saying, the curious task of economics is to demonstrate to men how little they really know about what they imagine they can design. All right? If you think about it this way, I have a diagram in the book which has a 2x2 matrix. And it has the position of the government on one side, right, on the top, and then on the side I have the role of the economist. And what I divide the state into, or the government into, is the state as a referee. So it's my understanding, by the way, that at Loyola you have a lot of students from Latin America. Is that still true that come here? So you guys oftentimes don't like real sports, you like soccer. And I noticed one thing about soccer fans, they get really worked up into a frenzy, right? Like, I love basketball, I still love basketball. I want to spend the winter in Italy watching basketball, because it's the only place on earth that they sing in the middle of a basketball game, right? And I want to go to the games, you know, they're doing all this stuff. And so I watch European basketball, I'm like crazy, right? And I watch the soccer games, and like, you beat each other, and you do all these things like that. What's the worst thing that could happen in a soccer game? If the referee causes your team to lose, right? The referee interferes in a game. What do you love about a soccer game? Well, okay, your team wins, but one of the things that you would love to see is that you wouldn't even notice the referee in the game, but yet they govern the game. That's the government as a referee. We shouldn't even see it, right? Ever. The other thing is the government is an active player in the economic game. The government is seen as a corrective to all social ills. All right, now, I can either see the state as a referee or the state as an active player. Now, if I'm an economist, I'm going to divide the economist into the economist as a student of society and the economist as a savior. Keynes, in the second volume of his biography on Keynes, is called The Economist as Savior because Keynes claimed that for himself. Right? That's the fact that the record, you know, we are the savior, right? So, the economist as savior, economist as student, economist as savior. Now, here's something interesting. When Adam Smith was writing, the state was seen as a referee, not as an active player. And economists that claimed that they were saviors, they were subject to ridicule. Adam Smith refers to them as men of systems, who believe that they can move people around as if they are pieces on a chessboard. And that was the common wisdom of economics. In Adam Smith's famous chapter on the invisible hand, the discussion of the invisible hand, he gives a point, he says, look, not only does the government not have the ability to guess how men should use their own capital, but we would nowhere trust that in a man who had the presumption and folly to imagine himself fit to tell you how to run your own life. He's making fun. It's like a joke, just Scottish Enlightenment version. Okay? Of these kind of things. By the time we get to Keynes, if you hold the Smithian position, you're viewed as a fatalist. someone who's not taking the decisive action that needs to be taken at this moment in time. And instead, the economist is viewed as the person that must do what? Control aggregate demand. Right? Decide how to use the budget to be able to fix the economy, not worry about balancing the budget, and so forth and so on. And so what I want to say to you is that if you imagine that 2x2 matrix, there's only two equilibria. The state as a referee, the economist as a student, which is a very humble view. That's where economics really is, a branch of philosophy. Or the economist as, the state as an active player, and the economist as a savior, in which case economics needs to be like social engineering. All right. Why did I write this quote? Has anyone ever here been to Guatemala? Just a few people here, okay. The University of Guatemala that 2 years ago contracted me to go down there and oversee their curriculum and examine and give, ideas. I went down there with a colleague of mine, Chris Coyne, close colleague of mine, and we went down there. It's called University of Francisco Marroquin. University of Francisco Marroquin is a very fascinating university because it was founded by a man named Manuel Ayau, who was educated here in North America in mechanical engineering. And he went back down to his home in Guatemala, wanting to look for a job as a mechanical engineer. And he found out that he couldn't find any work as a mechanical engineer because they weren't building. And he started asking himself questions. Why is it that they're not building here? And as a result, he became a very successful businessman, but not as a mechanical engineer. And he started asking himself these questions. Why is there not economic opportunities? When I was in Canada or the United States, there's all these economic opportunities. Why aren't there opportunities here in Guatemala? And so in order to answer that question, he founded a think tank which studied economics and mainly the division of labor. What allows the division of labor? Expansion of productive capacity of mankind. What thwarts the division of labor? And then from that, he decided to found a university. And in that university, it's like a dream come true to people like me, because every student has to take economics. It has a medical school, you gotta take a year of economics. You got dentistry, year of economics. Architecture, year of economics. Right? Political science, year of economics. You cannot, he got everyone in their curriculum study economics, so it's this amazing place. And all the architecture of the place is to highlight economic ideas. Right? And so we went down there and we started doing it, and during the process of being down there and examining their curriculum, the idea came up that a book like what I'm trying to do would actually fit their purpose, and that's actually how the book kind of came about. And in that, I make a distinction between mainline economics and mainstream economics, because you hear a lot of people say things like, oh, your positions you hold are not mainstream. I have taught at New York University, which is a top 10 department in economics. I have taught at the London School of Economics, which is a top university in economics in Europe. I spent a year at Stanford, which is a great university for economics. I've never once felt out of step as an economist. I have felt that people didn't agree with me. And we had to have intellectual disagreements. Remember the branches of the trees? That's the nature of science. I have felt at times that I wasn't up to the challenge. People that are on the other side might be smarter. And they might actually, beat me out in the debate. And then what that means is I go home and I study more. But I never once felt like I was kicked out. One of my favorite scenes is in the movie Splash. In the movie Splash, right? This is where Tom Hanks, it's a young Tom Hanks, and young Daryl Hannah, she's a mermaid. And there's a scientist named Bloombot. And he's been chasing around his whole life looking for a mermaid. Because he saw her when she was a young kid, right? And so he's looking for the mermaid. And he finally finds her. And they capture her. And then the main scientist, let's say MIT scientist, are studying the mermaid, and this guy complains that they're treating her unethically because they're testing her and all these things like that. And he says to him, he says, listen, I never considered you part of my community. Why don't you now go and run and find a unicorn? That would be someone kicking you out of the scientific community and dismissing you, your view. I have never felt that. And so when kids, especially young kids, come to me and they say, oh, I never heard of these ideas. Well, that's kind of weird, because the people that I'm talking about all won the Nobel Prize in economics. So, like, who's been teaching you economics? Like, Chucklehead McGee? Right? So, you know, what's going on here? Like, maybe you got a bad education in economics. Right? Oh, I never heard of, you know, F.A. Hayek, or I never heard of Ludwig von Mises. Really? Well, if you read, like, John Kenneth Galbraith, he goes out of his way to attack Mises in the most popular book in the 1960s, The Affluent Society. Who's his targets? Hayek? Mises. Being a target of somebody doesn't mean that you're out of, you know what it means to be out of the mainstream? They don't pay attention to you at all. Like, who's that? I never heard of that person, right? Not when they sit there, Mises' Human Action comes out, it's reviewed in the New York Times. I would kill someone to have my book reviewed in the New York Times. Right? Right? If I had a choice right there, well, you're dead. I want my book reviewed in the New York Times, right? You know, these guys, this is one distinguished fellow from the American Economic Association. You don't win that award unless you're a major thinker in your field. It's not like any, you know, Tom, Dick, or Harry like says, hey, main distinguished fellow, right? I'll give you lots of money. No, that's not allowed to happen. Right? It's because your Mises won the top award in the country of Austria for the top scientist. Right? He's a major thinker. Meeting Hayek wins a Nobel Prize. These people are big deals. My professor, James Buchanan, Nobel Prize. Ronald Coates, Nobel Prize. Why are these people weird? They're not weird. They won the Nobel Prize. All right? So where are you saying that these ideas? So they then go on to mean, well, people must mean something else. They must mean something else by these terms. So, if we go back to my tree, there's a main line of economics that runs from Adam Smith and David Hume to John Baptiste Say and Frederick Bastiat to John Stuart Mill, David Ricardo, okay, into Menger, Mises, Hayek, Armin Alchin, right, Israel Kirzner, right? All these other people, Vernon Smith, James Buchanan, Gordon Tullock, there's a whole tradition of that. They all belong as the men who sit in the seat of Adam Smith. And then there's mainstream, which is, you must mean by that, not substantive propositions about how you understand economics, but who's like, cool. Right? Remember high school? Like, who's cool? Right? So that's like the mainstream. So what does it mean to be cool? It means that you teach at Harvard, Princeton, Chicago, MIT, or Stanford. In economics, it's not really cool to teach at Yale. Right? Like you're a wannabe if you're at Yale. But if you're at Princeton, you haven't made it. Right? You're part of the in crowd. And so what we have is we have a difference between the mainstream, which is a sociological construct, and a mainline, which is a substantive proposition. All right, and that sort of dawned on me and became a major theme in the way in which I approach this stuff. So this is UFM, and this is, UFM believes, it's by the way, remember what I said, it's founded by a businessman. What's the difference between businessmen and academics? Businessmen sweat the details. Academics paint in broad brushes. So everything about this university is detail-oriented to make sure the students are constantly inundated with the ideas and messages that the administration wants to get from them. Everywhere they turn, there's images. The new Socratic seminar room is called the Karl Menger Room in the Michael Polanyi College. Everything is named, brand new building that they just put up right there. Okay? So everything about this is to signal this. So this is not going to do this justice, what I'm going to do next, because so the business school is here, and the economics department is over there by, say, where Professor D'Amico is. And I had to walk across a bridge. So you walk across a bridge from the business school, because we advised across all the different disciplines. And then once I get across the bridge, I'm confronted with a mural. And the mural wraps around, it goes like this and then stops. And then there's a second wall, let's say that Professor D'Amico's over there. And then there's another wall there. And then there's going to be, at the end of that, a major quote that they hold about the importance of economics. And we saw this every day we were there. This is distorted because I can't get it to be big enough and yet reflect it. It's a 20 by 20 foot mural, okay? 20 by 20, it's huge. And it starts with Richard Cantillon, who wrote the first, many people attribute the first systematic treatise in economics, okay? And then it carries through on the first one all the way up through the, as I said, the classical economists, the French liberals, the British utilitarians, the Austrian marginalists, and then you have, you know, the modern Austrian school, let's say, represented by Ludwig von Mises. And then the next wall, which comes us closer to the modern age, you know, has Henry Hazlitt and Hayek, Friedman, Doug North, Ronald Coase, Murray Rothbard, Gary Becker, Vernon Smith, Israel Kirzner, okay? So, and then there's the modern generation after that, which is not yet up on the wall. So the question became, to me, who's on the wall and who's not on the wall? And what was the criteria by which you put them on the wall and you didn't put them on the wall? And I pondered this. So Dan asked me a question. He said, I said to all of you, all of the students that I went with before, I said, you want to know what you should study? What keeps you up late at night? What wakes you up at 3 o'clock in the morning and you ponder like, okay, why is this the case? Okay? Part of my job as an economics instructor is to get you to be excited about the mystery of the mundane. All right, when my background was in studying socialist economies. And in the 1980s, you're gonna have a new movie coming out, Red Dawn Part 2, okay? Which is with the Chinese, it's terrible. But the first one was really bad too, with Patrick Swayze, but it was about the Russians, okay? Russians and the Cubans. But you gotta put yourself in that mindset, or watch Rambo from that period, right? He takes out a Soviet MiG with an arrow, right? Or Rocky, right? You know, Rocky with Dragos or whatever, you know. You be hitting me and I be hitting you, you know, all that stuff, right? So we were all heightened. Listen to Sting. Russians are people too. That was a song, right? And the belief was the world was gonna, you know, constantly blow up any minute. So Ted Turner decided, and one of his things that he would do is he would try to communicate to Americans the beauty of Russia, and that Russians are in fact just like us. And so he had a train that ran from Moscow to Vladivostok, and he did interviews with different people so that we'd be exposed to the average Russians, and therefore we wouldn't hate them, and therefore we wouldn't want to send a bomb to kill them. Right? That was the idea. So they had an interview with a professor from Columbia who was visiting at Moscow State University, MGU, and she's there, and they say to her, what's the difference between living in Moscow versus living in New York City? And at first, she's like, nothing, it's great. Then she stops, totally unedited, unscripted, everything, just stops. And she says, well, there is one big difference. When I'm back at Columbia, if I want to go to get a cucumber in January, all I need to do is go to the Grand Union and a cucumber's there. But if I'm here in Moscow in August and there's reports that there's a bumper crop, but I can't get cucumbers, that bothers me. And then they just moved on quickly. To me, I'm like, ding, 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 ding. That's the
puzzle of economics. Where are the cucumbers coming from? Right? How do I explain that? You know, and I go, you know, I'm at the cocktail party with my wife, and I'm like, the cucumbers. And everyone's like, shut up. It's the mystery of the mundane. Right now, there's a YouTube video up that tries to capture the iPencil story. So I recommend that you go look at that, okay? Milton Friedman, on the cover of Free to Choose, holds up a number two pencil. He gets a story from a man named Leonard Reed, who wrote The Family Tree of the iPencil. Adam Smith, by the way, in The Wealth of Nations, did it for a common woolen coat on the back of a day laborer. What they show is the number of exchanges far exceed the ability of any one of us to be able to understand and organize those exchanges. We instead marshal the self-interest of all of these individuals throughout the world to be able to produce the number one pen, the number two pencil, right, that you hold. So I recommend that you look at this video, because that's such a simple product, but yet think about all the people that are embedded in through the division of labor in producing just that simple product. Now think about things like your shoes, your pants, the sweater that you're wearing, the glasses that you're wearing, right? This is the mystery of the mundane. If you get excited about that, right, then you're starting to learn what economics is about and understand that. That's called the invisible hand. How it is that individuals, in pursuing their self-interest, will generate a publicly desirable outcome. Right? That's why we have the mystery of economics. Right? And so how is it the people that end up on this wall, those are the ones who understand the invisible hand. The ones who don't end up on the wall, Karl Marx, Thomas Malthus, John Maynard Keynes, Paul Krugman, Joe Stiglitz, all significant figures, but what didn't they get? They don't understand the invisible hand. It's not an ideological position. It's an analytical issue. How is it that you can possibly imagine how individuals pursuing their self-interest will generate a publicly desirable outcome? And explicating that mechanism. That's what economists do. They explain those cucumbers. They can explain the absence of those cucumbers. By the way, it's not really tricky. It's called incentives. All right? So if you walk away from here with anything tonight, understand something. How it is that individuals pursuing their self-interest gets translated into a publicly desirable outcome is through an institutional framework of property, prices, and profit and loss. Property gives us incentives, prices give us information, profit and loss gives us innovation. Go back to Hans Riesling's video. The countries that are poor and sick, they lack secure property rights, they have administered pricing, they don't have accurate profit and loss accounting. They are dealing with distorted incentives, perverse incentives, distorted information, and inaccurate profit and loss accounting. Okay? Here's another thing. If I privatize profits and socialize losses, don't be surprised when things go haywire. By the way, welcome to the modern financial market in the United States. And that's why you had a crisis in 2008. Not because of greed. Greed's like air. It's always there. Why did it get distorted in this particular way? Okay? It got distorted in that particular way because you set up a system where people privatize their profits, socialize their losses. So you look a smart guy. Let's go to Vegas. You and I go to Vegas. And I say to you, hey, you know what? You make any losses at the roulette wheel, I'll pay for you. But you get to keep all the profits that you're going to do. What kind of bets are you going to do?
Large bets.
Yeah, on 17, you're going to hold it or are you going to like say, put it down? Yeah, right? Welcome to AIG. Okay? That's what's going on there, okay? So we have to change that system, otherwise we're going to distort this. So who qualifies and who doesn't? Okay, let me finish up here. So all of this stuff matters for the things that we talk about today. So Adam Smith still is relevant for our conversations today, because the way Adam Adam Smith analyzed questions we still can rely on to answer questions for us today. Remember that tree? Adam Smith, in the fifth book of The Wealth of Nations, remember the title of the book, An Inquiry into the Nature and Causes of the Wealth of Nations. In the fifth part of that book, it's advice to a potential statesman, basically telling him to play this humble role rather than an activist role, which is what mercantilism was. And he's comparing and contrasting. What Adam Smith argues is that, look, here's the problem. Let's get right down to it. Governments, ancient as well as modern, like to engage in a juggling trick. And here's the juggling trick. They want to spend money because they want to do things now. Adam Smith actually points out about 10 pages prior to this passage that the reason why they do this is because they want to engage in military adventurism, because that's enjoyment for them. Watch them battle down there and I'm up on the hill. And, kind of like going to a football game. Alright? So like bad things are going on. So that costs money to do that. So do I want to pay for that? Right? So how am I going to pay for it? I'm going to run a deficit. That deficit becomes part of an accumulating public debt. That public debt then represents an obligation. So what am I going to do? I'm going to debase my currency to pay the debt back, right, with cheaper money. So, since I killed you before, let me bring you up, right? So, imagine that you're gonna go Christmas shopping for your family and friends, and what I do is I give you a counterfeit machine in the bottom of your basement that's perfect. You'll never get caught, I tell you. You're not gonna get caught, and you can believe me, right? You're never gonna get caught, it's perfect, looks just like dollars. What is your effective budget constraint when you go out there to buy presents for your family? No, right? You're giving your sisters a Mercedes-Benz. Here you go, sweetie. I love you so much. Here's your Mercedes-Benz, right? Like this. A gentleman recently, Jerry Jordan, who used to be one of the governors of the Fed, I was talking, and he came up to me afterwards, and he said, you know what the problem is with our arithmetic in our country today? It's like as if I went to my executor, and I'm going to die, right? And what my executor gets is this order after I die, which was, I have three daughters. Each of my daughters gets one half of my estate. Among my six grandchildren, we divide what's left over equally. Okay? Note who the problem is. Not my promise, the executor. Right? This is the issue of passing these things down the road, okay? So Adam Smith warned us about this because what we're doing is we're engaging in an endless cycle of deficits, debt, and debasement. And we have unleashed this since 1950. For the first 150 years of the United States, look this up, we basically ruled under a balanced budget rule, which said that any time that you ran deficits, you tried to eliminate those deficits in the next round as fast as possible. So you run budget deficits during times of crisis, war, things like that. But then in the next round, you would try to offset them. So we basically ruled under what was called a budgetary balance norm. Since 1950, we adopted a philosophy called functional finance, which says that you use the budget to balance the economy, you never worry about balancing the budget. And after that became our norm, we have balanced the budget only very few times. Okay? Increasingly out of budget. All right? During that time, increasing numbers coming out of that, okay? So let's take a look. I won't go into all the other debates here. I just want to end with this one. But let's take a look at like our current public policy with regard to meeting the crisis. So again, property prices and profit loss. If you want some background on this, you know, read Democracy and Deficit by Jim Buchanan and Richard Wagner. And read F.A. Hayek's little essay book, monograph called Tiger by the Tail. It's about the relationship between deficits and inflation. Okay? So that's a good way to frame the debate of what's going on. Well, what has Bernanke engaged in? Bernanke, by the way, is like the sweetest guy in the world to get this job. He's very, very well trained as an economist, was a monetary historian of the Great Depression. His reason why he's engaged in the activities engaged in is precisely connected to his academic work on why the Great Depression took place. So you can trace it back and you see a logic behind that position. But what he's engaged in is a thing called quantitative easing, okay? And when you engage in quantitative easing, what you do is you're monetizing, okay? And the expectations are gonna be that long-run interest rates should be going up. Okay, everyone with me? If you're a bank and you expect you're gonna loan money to him, now the original rate right now is 4% and you're gonna lend money to him, but you expect that he's gonna pay you back that loan in 10 years from now, but in between we're gonna have 10% inflation, right? You don't wanna just get 4% because then you just lost money. Everyone with me? So what's gonna happen is you're gonna creep that interest rate up, because 10 years from now, you're gonna want him to pay you the interest rate that you're charging plus the inflation rate to be able to get your money, 14%, right? So, that's a hedge. At 4%, would you borrow the money? At 14%, would you borrow the money? You might not. You wanna lend money. So if he's not gonna do it because your rates are going up, right, he's not going to engage in activity, that sort of stalls the economy. That's market actors hedging, right? You, on the one hand, raise the interest rate. He reacts to that by making money now more, you know, difficult for him to obtain. Well, Bernanke wants to stimulate the economy, so he doesn't want that going on, right? So what did he do? Besides also engaging in QE3, they engage in what's called Operation Twist, which is he's lending you the money, and I'm buying up all those long-term treasuries to keep the interest rates down. So I'm gonna keep long-term rates down and short-term rates down. All right, this is a monetary policy that's going on at the moment. All right, that's gonna have to be adjusted. So Smith argued, let's go back now to Adam Smith. He said, look, governments are engaged in this endless act of deficits, debt, and debasement, juggling tricks. So just think about that. Here I am, I'm juggling. Right, this is what's bad. How do I stop me from juggling? Well, one, take the balls away from me, or the juggling sticks. Two, tie my hands behind my back. Three, chop my arms off. Right? That's really the only way, right? By the way, I could be even a skilled juggler behind my back, right? So chopping the arms off might actually be good. So now, it turns out, by the way, that if you study the history of modern thinkers in economics, what they've done is they've gone through various different things. Think about Milton Friedman. What's a monetary rule? That's trying to tie their hands behind the back. What's Hayek's denationalization of money? That's cutting off the arms, right? But the point that Adam Smith is doing is saying, look, you need to stop the juggling. The juggling is what destroys nations. Inquiry into the nature and causes of the wealth of nations. You let endless juggling take place, nations fall. So why do nations fail? It's because they do things like QE2 and QE3 and Operation Twist in mass. All right, and that's when money dies, system enters into this crisis and things like that. I'm not saying we're going there, right? Understand that, right? There's puzzles that we still have, like why is it that we don't see foreign investment leaving the United States rather than staying in? It must be that the United States is a better investment opportunity than other countries at the moment, okay? Which might tell you really bad things are going on in other countries as well, right? But these are the kind of questions that we have to do. All right, so that's enough of that. We can answer other questions. So let me just finish with two slides here that will take me a very short period of time. So here's what I want to end with, the message. Economics is the greatest thing that could ever happen to your life. Fall in love with economics. It is the it science. It's very cool, all right? And the reason why it's cool is that it explains human action across all walks of life, okay? It's the science of human action. It's not just about prices and money, all right? It's about human decision-making in all walks of life. It's also the most important subject. It's about the wealth and poverty of nations. You can't answer an inquiry into the nature and causes of wealth of nations without investing a lot of time in understanding economics. You just will simply not have an answer to that question. You can't have an answer to the empirical reality that Hans Riesling is giving you. That there were countries that were poor and sick, and now they're healthy and wealthy. Why? He doesn't ask that question. He asks a what question. Most historians, for example, ask what questions? What happened? Right? Economists are the mechanism about why things happen. Why what happened happened. That's an economics answer. Okay? That's why we need economics. All right. So, there's been a meme, which Loyola should jump into. But you guys, I don't know, that's up to you to do. Dan's not pushing this, so he's failing on the meme front. But his, a former Loyola graduate is the responsible for this picture, Nick Snow. And this is the idea of the main line of economics and how it's emerging. And I always use in this, but I can use lots of different examples. All right, Professor Stringham here. It has a new book coming out with Oxford, which is on the history of private policing and private ordering mechanisms. Professor D'Amico works on, you know, prison systems and punishment systems. Professor Snow over here, another Loyola graduate, two Loyola graduates here, one Holy Cross graduate. They're all blockheads. The Snow here is working on economics of prohibition. So I could use many different examples of people who are doing economics as entertaining. Right? Nick has a paper on rum runners. He also has a paper on hooligans. You remember the soccer guys? All right, so the hooligans, right? He asks these interesting questions, all right, about these things. These are two of the books that I use. These are two of my colleagues that I work with at George Mason every day. One of them is Peter Leeson, and I highly recommend reading this book. It's called The Invisible Hook, The Secret Economics of Pirates, and it's about how the pirates organize their thing based on economic principles. It's an amazingly fun read. Ryan Princeton just released a version of it, which is for management professors, which is basically how Blackbeard would teach an MBA class. So Blackbeard was out to maximize the booty. How does it go? Very entertaining. Chris Coyne, right? What his work is about is after-war reconstructions, when countries are torn apart, how do they try to put their pieces back together? What are the missteps that they make? What are that? He has a new book coming out, which is called Doing Bad by Doing Good, which is about the critique of humanitarian aid and efforts at doing that and how it generates perverse incentives and whatnot. In both of these cases, these guys are developing the intellectual tradition of mainline economics, in which economics is the most entertaining subject and economics is the most important subject. So when you're entertaining and important, you have to live economics. Okay, thanks. Anyone have any questions? I gotta have something that annoyed somebody so they ask some questions. Yes, sir.
So, economics cannot be the engineers of the world at any point. What would you say is the proper place of an economist in the job market or in the world? I mean, you could say academic, you can say public policy, but what else?
Well, that's a great question. So the question is, what role do economists play, or what are they valued at doing? Now, this gets a little mixed up because there's also a view about what economists might be able to do, but that's not, they don't get hired to do what we think they're going to do. That's mainly in public policy that they get hired for that. In the private sector, and also in other walks, it turns out that, by the way, economics among all undergraduate majors make more money. Now I'm an economist, right? So I'm going to give you money responses, okay? Make more money than any other social science. So if you are in the social science, if you want to make a lot of money, right, and you're in undergraduate school right now, you should be in engineering, okay? And then get an MBA from Harvard or something like that. Maybe now get an MBA from Acton MBA or whatever. And then you're going to make you'll be a serial entrepreneur, you'll make a ton of money, okay? But if you're in the social sciences, that is, you're studying political science, you study sociology, studying history, right, whatever, these things on the art side of things, economics does the best in terms of financial remuneration coming out of school. It also does the best for students that go to law school. They have the highest GRE rates, They also have the highest GMAT rates. Okay? So economics is an amazingly and good background for law school, for graduate school, for, you know, anything else that you want to do. Now, why would that be the case? You know how I was ragging on economics earlier? Well, here's the problem with my ragging on economics. Now I'm going to make an appeal here. If I teach a very heavy math economics program and a heavy graphical theory program, this is going to sound bad, but I'm going to say it anyway. Stupid people can't graduate. Right? They just got weeded out. There's no room for, like, emotions. There's no haiku economics. Like, oh, I just think. It's my feelings. And by eliminating that, you eliminate, you know, 90% of the crap that goes on at universities, right? And so, you know, you have a determinant answer, right? You have a simultaneous equation system. Can you figure out the P and Q vector? If you're the type of person that can figure out the P and Q vector that clears the market, you're pretty much, you know, okay. If I give you a tough task, you might be able to work on it. Because remember that in school, most of what we're doing in school is signaling, right? So we do signaling and we do matching, not training, right? That's what we know about the economics of higher education. So what do I mean by that? Well, you get matching means not just marriage, right? It also means like who your friends are. So who your peer group is that you get to know and they hook you into jobs and things like that, right? And the other one is you signal. If you graduate from college, you do it on 4 years on time, you do it in a difficult manner. Here's an interesting thing on this. Do you know that the greatest indicator of your starting salary is not your SAT score, but the average SAT score of the freshman class when you entered college? Pure signaling. An engineer from MIT is going to make more than an engineer from Grove City College. Right? Not, and a kid at Grove City College could in fact have a 1500 on his SATs. And the kid at MIT has a 1500 on SATs. But what we care about is the signaling aspect. Now, what's interesting about that is that that effect wears out within the decade. Right? And then it's all really, so here's the number one thing. IQ, it's better to be smart than it is to be dumb. Okay? But it's not the determining factor. You know what the determining factor is? Hard work. If you're a hard worker, you'll do better than lazy and smart. Right? I used to coach basketball for many years at the high school. I had to cut kids. It's the hardest thing in the world to cut kids, especially, you know, their dreams are all, like, true. So I coached for about 20 years total. And I used to say to some of the kids, I'd say, look, you're small and slow. That doesn't really work. Maybe you should try wrestling or something, you know, like that. You know, basketball's maybe not in your future. And, you know, crying, you know, like, it was terrible. But, you know, you have to, like, just, you know, let them know, right, on these things. So what the most important thing to do is, if you're not going to be like a wizard, is you got to work really hard. Okay? And you can outwork a lot of people who are wizards. All right? And so hard work is more of a determinant of success than anything else. But economics is an outstanding social science educational background for a variety of approaches. I hope that kids study economics and then want to study economics further. But it also is a very disciplined, you know, approach. It has a independent of perspectivism kind of thing. There's a supply and demand, there's a P and a Q space, you have to be able to figure that out. There's statistics, and you gotta know what a T-stat is, you gotta know what an R-squared is, you gotta know how to do that. And if you can't do that, you can't do those classes. If you can do that, you can signal that you can learn a lot of things. So learning how to learn, economics is very good at teaching that. Yeah?
Following on that point, it seems that we have a lot more people in this country in college than should be in college. I was wondering if you could give your viewpoint on, is it more profitable for, you know, students to drop out of school and actually get a job, or not? If you're not going to be a mechanic.
I want to have a job. Don't do that. Don't quit. No, no, it's a, you know, so Peter Thiel, right? So anyone here know who Peter Thiel is?
PayPal.
Yeah, PayPal. Does anyone else know about Peter Thiel? What do you know about him?
One of the
original investors in Facebook. Yeah, you saw the movie too, right? Yeah, so Justin Timberlake. So Peter, what?
He also has a sculpture about where he's offering
Yeah, speak up so everyone can hear you here.
For 20 college students, he's offering $100,000 each for a startup business that they might start.
250.
So what Peter Thiel is arguing is we have too many people in college learning how to be organizational men and women rather than learning how to be entrepreneurs. And what we need to do is we need to cultivate a society of entrepreneurs, okay? So in that case, if you look at a lot of the great success stories in the tech age, a lot of these people left college. Now there's kind of a confusion here, right? So Bill Gates didn't graduate from college, but as a freshman, Bill Gates was taking PhD level courses, okay? So he's a little different. But Steve Jobs did. But take an idea of what Steve Jobs did. He dropped out of Reed College, and then what he did was he hung around. He was the original couch surfer, and he took classes like Egyptian writing. And he sat in on all these classes. His reasons for dropping out was that his parents were losing a boatload of money by putting him in college, and he didn't understand why they had to spend so much money, so he would audit classes instead. And then what happens is, that's called calligraphy, right? The Egyptian writing. And you know, you think, okay, what's so great about calligraphy? And as Steve Jobs points out, 10 years later, when he was developing fonts for Apple, calligraphy kicked in. And it's the reason why they have the unique fonts that they have. Okay, it was because Steve Jobs took that class. These are people that are connectors. They can connect knowledge, which is a great act of entrepreneurship. They connect knowledge here, connect knowledge there, and then they can put it together. In the modern world, you can build your portfolio as a student in many ways different than the standard academic route. I just went to a talk yesterday by Jeff Sandifer, who is the founder of the Acton MBA. He's now going to get started doing K-12 education using the same model. They have a contract with the students. The first thing is professors are not allowed to speak in class except to ask a question. Students have to sign a contract that they will do all the reading. And in the discussions in class, they videotape all the discussions, and students are given a 2, a 1, a 0, a minus 1, or a minus 2 based on their conversation in class. So if you ask stupid questions, you'll get marked down. But you're responsible for asking the questions, because answering the questions, because the professor is not allowed to tell you what the answer is. He's supposed to just provoke you with questions and guide the conversation. Socratic seminar, right? Gone crazy. And this is a radical and what he calls disruptive approach to education. They don't take any grades. It's based on written evaluation. So there's no grade. You'll get A, B, C, whatever, right? What you do is you get and you build your portfolio. And that's the idea, right? So education. Here's in the K-12 thing. They rely a lot on peer education. It turns out kids learn faster when they're being taught by, they don't believe in the single age, you know, one classroom, one teacher, single age, you know, fifth grade, sixth grade, seventh grade. They believe in the following thing, elementary school. And so in that group, you have 8-year-olds all the way up to 13-year-olds. And it turns out, by the way, the 13-year-olds in those classrooms take ownership over helping the 8-year-olds get along. And peer-to-peer teaching turns out to be much more effective than the standard model of us standing up there. How many here have heard of the Khan Academy? This is revolutionizing education as well. So you go online and you hear a presentation about how to do this stuff. Here's another example, hole in the wall. Has anyone ever heard of the Hole in the Wall initiative? It's in India. You have heard of it.
Yeah, is that where they put the computer in the classroom?
Yeah, right? Speak up, tell everyone about it.
So there's shortage of teachers and lots more students. So it was found that if you just give a classroom a computer with tons of kids and write some questions on the board, kids will actually use a computer to look up things that, like, somebody twice our age might not even know, and through the internet and talking with each other, kind of teach themselves.
So it started out, great summary. So it started out, this professor was at the, you know, was in Mumbai, right? And what he did was his classroom, his office, backed right up to a slum area. And so what he did was he simply had them build a thing and put a computer outside among with the slum kids with no directions, like go use the computer or anything like that. And all of a sudden the kids started going over there. Here's a fascinating story. These kids have never been exposed to TV, they never did anything like that. Do you know what they settled in on as number one thing that they went to visit? They're young kids. Disney.com. All right, so they thought at first, oh, this is terrible. We don't want to have them going to Disney.com. We want them to go to the Khan Academy and learn how to do algebra or whatever, right? And so what they did was they set up a system so that they blocked the Disney.com website. It took the kids less than a week to figure out how to hack out of that thing. All right, these are advanced computer science professors putting in, you know, this thing. So this hole in the wall initiative is this idea of how much kids, by tapping into our natural curiosity, kids can teach themselves. So remember my first, you know, point about economics, which is that it's not a catechism, it's an invitation to inquiry, right? Well, that's because we want to tap into your curiosity. Your curiosity is your greatest asset, right? I tell all these guys, they've all heard this before when they were sitting in my classroom, I say, curiosity may kill the cat, but it fuels the scholar. When I mentioned the thing about the cucumber, right, that's a curiosity thing. But most of us don't pay attention to it, right? Because we're not, you know, like, we just take it for granted. But instead, if we allow our natural curiosity to take over, right, you might ask yourself questions. Like, think about it this way. I was on a plane today from Washington, D.C. to here. Why does it fall in the sky? Like, how the hell is that working? Right? If I'm a young kid, young kids who are unschooled ask questions like that. How do planes fly? And you know what that leads to? Studying, you know, aeronautics. All kinds of amazing things. So let your curiosity go. So does college kill your curiosity or increase it? If college is increasing your curiosity, and allowing you to connect dots like the way that Steve Jobs did. So from calligraphy to being able to have software fonts, right, that are able to do things and look a certain way that otherwise they wouldn't. College is doing its job, and it should be, in fact, embraced completely, right? On the other hand, if college has become boring to you, and it's like rote memorization, and you're like, oh my God, you know, I gotta get up at 8 o'clock this morning and go to this, drag my butt out of this bed and go to that class, and doesn't this suck? And the professor drones on. Right then, college isn't doing its job. But you know what? Adam Smith recognized that.